great way to think about things.
Okay.
So we'll start with the common and less serious causes.
Okay.
And then we'll move into the, you know, really important, serious and potentially fatal causes section.
Right.
So we want you to, you know, really be able to tell the difference and when to get help.
Okay, so let's jump right into that first category, the common and less serious causes. I feel like the one everyone's probably familiar with, at least a little bit, is migraines. And the guide splits these into, like, migraine without aura, which they call common migraine, and then migraine with aura, which is classic migraine. What's the main thing to understand about the difference there?
Well, the big difference, obviously, is whether there's an aura or not. For migraine without aura, they have this really easy way to remember it. It's pulsating pain, nausea, light, and sound sensitivity.
Oh.
Which really, I mean, that sums it up. So usually you're talking about, you know, a throbbing pain, often on one side of the head. That's what unilateral means. And it can be, you know, moderate or totally debilitating and last anywhere from 4 hours to 3 whole days, which is 72 hours.
Wow.
And moving around usually makes it worse. And it often comes with nausea, maybe even throwing up and being really sensitive to light and sound. Photophobia and photophobia, you know, fancy terms.
Right, like when just regular lights and sounds feel like way too much.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's a big clue. What about migraine with aura? What's that like?
So with a classic migraine, the aura is like a warning sign that the headache's coming.
Hmm.
The guide calls these visual and sensory symptoms before pain. So you might see, you know, flashing lights or like zigzag lines or even like a temporary blind spot in your vision. You might also have weird sensory stuff going on, like a tingling, pins and needles feeling, what they call paresthesia, maybe even temporarily lose some vision.
Wow.
Or have trouble speaking, which is called dysarthria. It's like your nervous system is doing all these funky things before the actual headache starts.
So it's probably pretty freaky if you've never experienced it. In terms of treatments for these migraines, what does the guide say?
So for when the migraine's actually happening, the acute treatment, it lists things you've probably heard of, like NSAIDs, think like ibuprofen or naproxen, acetaminophen, aspirin, also antiemetics to help with the nausea. And then there's a specific type of drug called triptans that can be really good at like stopping the migraine pain. And it mentions that if you get migraines all the time, it might be worth talking to your doctor about preventative treatment, what they call prophylaxis.
Yeah, that makes sense. Okay, let's move on to another common one that I think feels pretty different, which is the tension headache.
Yeah, tension headaches are definitely different. The guide says they're usually bilateral, so both sides of your head. Mm-hmm. The pain is usually not throbbing, more like a constant dull ache, kind of like a tight band or pressure around your head.
Mm-hmm.
And important point, usually moving around doesn't make it worse.
Right.
And the intensity is, you know, mild to moderate, can last anywhere from like half an hour to a whole week.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so quite a range.
And what are the main things that might cause tension headaches?
The biggest culprits they list are stress and not enough sleep. So if you're feeling overwhelmed or you're not getting good rest, you're more likely to get one.
Yeah, I think that resonates with a lot of people.
Probably.
What about treatment?
So for treating tension headaches, it's often similar to those milder migraines. Over-the-counter painkillers like NSAIDs, acetaminophen, or aspirin. And for prevention, since stress is a big trigger, they recommend stress management techniques like regular exercise, mindfulness, or even just making sure you get enough sleep can make a difference.
Makes sense. Okay, so those are the more common headaches. Now let's get into the scarier stuff, the serious and potentially fatal causes. And the guide makes it clear, like, we really need to know about these red flags.
Absolutely. While these are thankfully less common, recognizing the signs of these serious problems can be super important. The first one your guide goes into is a subarachnoid hemorrhage, or SAH.
And this headache is, like, dramatically different, right?
Yeah, it is. The guide says people often describe it as the worst headache of their life. And it comes on really suddenly. They call it a thunderclap headache. Like, it reaches its peak intensity in just a few minutes.
Wow.
It's not one that gradually builds up. It just hits you. So the main thing is, any sudden, super intense pain that's different from your usual headaches, that's when you need to worry.
Okay. So what else might you experience besides that sudden, crazy headache?
The guide says the pain can get worse if you exert yourself, and it often comes with nausea and vomiting. Also what they call meningeal signs,
okay,
which are basically signs that the membranes around your brain and spinal cord are irritated.
Hmm?
And besides a stiff neck, that can also include pain when you bend your neck forward.
So how do you figure out if someone has a subarachnoid hemorrhage?
They say a new generation CT scan of the head is really good at finding SAH, especially within 6 hours of the headache starting. But if they still think it might be SAH, even if the CT is normal after 6 hours, they might do a lumbar puncture, that's an LP, or a spinal tap, to check the cerebrospinal fluid for what's called xanthochromia. It's basically a yellowish color that means there's blood in the fluid.
Okay. And I'm guessing treating this is super time sensitive, right?
Absolutely. The guide's very clear. Urgent neurosurgery consult right away. No waiting around.
Okay, no messing around.
Nope.
The next one listed is headaches from increased intracranial pressure, or ICP. Mm. What we need to know about these?
So headaches from increased ICP often follow a pattern. They tend to be worse in the morning when you're lying down, what's called supine.
Okay.
And they get worse when you do things that increase the pressure in your head, like coughing or doing the Valsalva maneuver.
Okay.
Which is when you try to breathe out forcefully, but you're closing your airway, like when you strain during a bowel movement, you know?
Mm.
Yeah.
Okay, so are there any, like, physical signs that suggest increased ICP?
Yeah. The guide mentions neurological deficits, things like weakness or numbness.
Right.
And papilledema, which is swelling in the back of your eye that they can see during an eye exam, and that happens when the pressure in your head goes up.
Okay, so how do they usually diagnose increased ICP?
A CT scan of the head is usually the first step.
Okay.
And a lumbar puncture can be helpful too, but they have a big warning. Don't do it if you think the pressure in the skull is already high, because that can be dangerous.
Okay.
But if they think it might be something called idiopathic intracranial hypertension, which is basically when the pressure in your skull is high for no clear reason, then they might consider an LP.
Okay. And like with SAH, treating increased ICP is urgent too, right?
Yep. The guide again, neurosurgery consult needed.
Okay. Moving on, the guide talks about headaches from meningitis. Dang. That's an infection, right?
That's right. Meningitis is inflammation of the membranes around your brain and spinal cord, and it's usually caused by an infection. The main symptoms the guide lists are fever, stiff neck, and altered mental status, which means things like being confused or disoriented.
And are there any other things that might make you suspect meningitis?
Yeah, there can be. It mentions possible nausea, focal neurological signs like weakness in one arm or leg seizures, papilledema again, which is that swelling in the back of the eye we talked about, and sometimes a petechial rash, those little red or purple spots that don't go away when you press on them. Mm. And they might find a high white blood cell count in the spinal fluid from a lumbar puncture, and maybe even positive blood cultures if the infection's in the blood.
So it sounds like diagnosing this involves, like, ruling things out first.
Exactly.
Okay.
The guide says first rule out increased ICP because, as we said, doing an LP when the pressure in the skull is high can be dangerous.
Okay.
So if there are signs of increased ICP, like altered mental status, neurological signs, or papilledema, do a CT scan of the head first. If they don't think it's increased ICP, then do an LP to look at the spinal fluid.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
And I imagine treatment for meningitis needs to be started fast.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Super important. It says start empiric antibiotics early.
Okay.
That means broad spectrum antibiotics that they start even before they know exactly what's causing the infection. The specific ones they mention are ceftriaxone and vancomycin, and they add ampicillin if you're over 50 or have a weakened immune system.
Yeah.
They also mention potentially adding a cyclover for viruses and even steroids sometimes, but there's a huge warning. Don't delay antibiotics. With meningitis, every minute counts.
Wow. Okay, that's a good thing to remember. Next up is giant cell arteritis, which is also called temporal arteritis. This one sounds like it mostly affects older people.
Right. It says it's most common in people over 70 and more often in women.
Okay.
It's basically when certain blood vessels, especially in the head and neck, get inflamed.
Okay. And what are the usual symptoms of giant cell arteritis?
It lists headache, scalp tenderness, where even brushing your hair can hurt. Jaw pain when chewing, which they call jaw claudication, and also just generally feeling achy, fever, and maybe losing weight without trying.
So if someone comes in, are there any specific things you might find during the exam that point to this?
Yeah. Okay. A tender temporal artery, that's the one that runs along the side of your forehead, is a key finding. It also mentions RAPD, which stands for relative afferent pupillary defect. It's something they find during an eye exam, and maybe a swelling of the optic nerve, what they call optic dysedema.
Okay, so how do they usually diagnose it?
Usually it involves blood tests to check for inflammation, things like ESR and CRP.
Okay.
But the only way to know for sure is a temporal artery biopsy, where they take a tiny piece of the artery and look at it under a microscope.
It sounds like treatment needs to be started pretty quickly with this, too.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay.
It says start high-dose steroids right away if you suspect giant cell arteritis, even before you get the biopsy results back, to prevent bad complications like vision loss.
Okay, last one in this scary category. We have headaches from cerebral venous sinus thrombosis. What's that all about?
So this is when you get a blood clot in one of the venous sinuses in your brain. Those sinuses are responsible for draining blood away from the brain, and the headache can start in different ways. It can be gradual or come on really suddenly.
Okay, and what other symptoms might make someone suspect this?
They list vomiting, papilledema again, that swelling in the back of the eye we talked about.
Right.
Focal neurological deficits, things like weakness on one side of the body or trouble speaking, and also seizures and sudden mental status changes.
So I'm guessing diagnosing this involves imaging the brain.
Definitely.
Okay.
Neuroimaging is crucial. Usually a CT scan of the head and often a CT venogram too, which is a special type of CT scan that focuses on the veins in the brain.
Okay.
They might also do blood tests, like a complete blood count and coagulation studies. And sometimes a lumbar puncture can be helpful.
Okay. And how do they usually treat cerebral venous sinus thrombosis?
The main treatment is anticoagulation, which is basically using blood thinners.
Right.
Like LMWH, which is low molecular weight heparin, or regular heparin.
Okay, that was a great overview of all the different types of headaches in the guide. Now let's move on to the diagnosis and decision tools section. First up is the Ottawa SAH rule. What is that, and when is it helpful?
So the Ottawa SAH rule is basically a set of guidelines for doctors to figure out how likely it is that someone has a subarachnoid hemorrhage. They use it for patients who are alert, over 15 years old, and have a severe, non-traumatic headache that hit its worst point within an hour.
Okay, so there are times when you should use this rule and times when you shouldn't.
Right.
Okay.
The guide says when you should not use the Ottawa SAH rule. Like, if the patient has any neurological deficits on exam or a history of a brain aneurysm, a previous SAH, or a brain tumor. Also, if they have recurrent headaches, specifically three or more bad headaches in the past 6 months.
Okay, so if it seems okay to use the rule, what are the high-risk features that would mean you need to do more tests?
There are six high-risk features they list. Being 40 or older, having neck pain or stiffness, having passed out and someone saw it happen, the headache starting during exercise, it being a thunderclap headache, that really sudden, intense one, and having limited neck flexion on exam. And they mention a really important thing about this rule. It's super sensitive, so if none of those high-risk features are present, it's very unlikely it's a subarachnoid hemorrhage.
That's good to know. What does it say about how to treat a severe migraine in the ER?
It says they start with an IV bolus of 1 liter of normal saline solution, and then they might give prochlorperazine or metoclopramide, those are anti-nausea meds, ketorolac, which is an NSAID given through the IV for pain, and dexamethasone, which is a steroid to try to stop the migraine from coming back too soon. It also mentions other options like haloperidol, metoclopramide again, maybe at a different dose, ergotamine, sumatriptan, and other pain meds.
So it's like a whole bunch of things to address the pain, the nausea, and try to prevent it from coming back. According to this guide, when would someone need to be admitted to the hospital for a bad headache?
It lists a few reasons. If they think it might be one of those serious diagnoses we talked about, or if they've already diagnosed it, if the patient is older or has a weakened immune system because their symptoms might be different than usual, if there are any weird neurological findings on exam, or if their pain just doesn't get better with the oral meds they give in the ER.
Okay, and when might someone be okay to go home from the ER after being checked out for a bad headache?
They say it's usually okay to discharge someone if there are no red flags, so no signs of those scary conditions if their headache is better after treatment in the ER and if they've been told to follow up with their regular doctor for ongoing care.
Okay, they also specifically mentioned warning patients about the risks of misusing narcotic pain medications.
Yeah.
That seems really important, especially when you're dealing with severe pain.
Definitely.
Okay.
Since those meds can be addictive and have other bad side effects, it's super important to talk to patients about the risks.
Right.